Let us pray. Almighty God, by the power of your Holy Spirit, may your word be proclaimed this day. Grant us understanding that we may believe, and faith that we might follow our risen Lord, Jesus Christ. Amen. Interval training is a type of physical training that involves a series of low to high intensity workouts interspersed with periods of rest or relief periods. The high intensity periods are typically at or close to anaerobic exercise, while the recovery periods are of lower intensity. I prefer the lower intensity exercises myself. Interval training prepares your heart for increased efficiency because the heart, as a muscle, responds to maximum demands, not minimum ones. How applicable this is to life as a disciple of Jesus Christ, especially as understood in the season of Advent. Advent is a season of spiritual preparation. If our heart's desire is the kingdom of God, then it only makes sense that we look forward to Christ's coming. Every desire, every thought, every action of a disciple is one of expectation, looking forward. If the risen and glorious Lord of life is coming, then how I am living matters. My very being must strive to be a servant and a witness to Christ in all facets of my life. My spiritual life, as in matters physical, is one for which I must prepare for maximum demand. This leads me to ask, is my life one that glorifies Christ and in the process helps me to grow spiritually? Is my every effort helping me to respond to the maximum demands of God's Word and Spirit rather than the minimum? I suspect my honest response to these questions is a great indicator of my overall spiritual, moral, and ethical health. When we understand that spiritual growth is possible through faithful response to the opposition we face, then we can begin to understand the great irony of holiness, hope, and peace. Spiritual growth often comes in the midst of great stress, in the midst of fear, anger, frustration, and even conflict sometimes. This is the purpose of Advent, to prepare for the coming of the Lord. Look at Advent as a challenge and an opportunity to become spiritually fit, to be prepared, to grow in disciplines and practices that we so often overlook, preparing a straight path for Jesus in our lives, following the example of John the Baptist. Tertullian, the great North African church father, wrote of this truth centuries ago. Repentance, he wrote, should prepare the home of the heart by making it clean who desires to supervene. You know, we all know what it's like to feel defeated, to lose heart, to give up in the face of adversity, believing that there is no rhyme or reason for anything in life. At times like this, we're tempted to feel that God is detached, unaware, perhaps even indifferent. But at these critical moments in our lives, we need to remember and help each other to remember that God so loved the world, He sent His only begotten Son for us, for our salvation. In reality, it is sin that separates us from God. It is sin, that natural human tendency toward independence and pride, that that causes us to look at our lives through a skewed reality, or to hide, to disguise our feelings, our failures, our fears. But my friends, God will have none of this. Several years ago, experts restored the famous painting, The Night Watch, by Rembrandt. Apparently, the painting had hung for years in Amsterdam without proper attention, and over the years, it had acquired a heavy layer of dust and grime. As restorers painstakingly cleaned the masterpiece, they were astonished to find figures emerging in the shadows, figures long veiled by grime and dirt. When the painting was redisplayed, art lovers were amazed by the significance added by the restored exposure of the obscured figures. But nothing had been altered on the painting to give it new beauty. The dirt and grime were not a creation of the artist. They were intruders that were left unaddressed, slowly accumulating and subsequently hiding the artist's intended design. So often, this is the way with sin in our lives. Sin often creeps into our lives, accumulating without notice, hiding the essential dignity and the image of God in us. And the only thing that can cleanse us from this sin is the mercy and the forgiveness of God, which He made available through Jesus Christ, His Son. Etymologically, the word forgiveness comes from a Greek word meaning to let go. But understood properly, it's only the action of God, the movement which originates by the power of the Holy Spirit that draws humanity into a saving knowledge of God's actions through Jesus Christ. Advent, then, is a season we acknowledge our need to respond to the call of the prophet John the Baptist, who proclaimed, as our text puts it, a baptism of repentance for the forgiveness of sins. I hear so often that the life of discipleship is made to seem so simple. Regrettably, only the benefits of faith are extolled without disclosing the true costs of discipleship. This leads many people into frustration, disappointment, and disillusionment of their faith. When they face hardship, when they face those tough moments in life. In his writing, concluding an unscientific postscript, Soren Kierkegaard describes himself as a missionary to a non-Christian land that actually thought it was Christian. He saw himself as someone who was called to introduce Christianity to a culture where everyone thought they already had a handle on what it means to be a Christian. Kierkegaard believed that the average Dane of the 19th century thought that Christianity was simply knowledge, information which, if mastered and technique if practiced, could lead to greater happiness. He writes in protest of this heresy that being a Christian is not simply the discovery of the correct answers. For Christianity is not information, not simply command of Scripture, or all the right theologies and answers, but rather a person, Jesus Christ. It's not what we know, it's whom we trust and follow. Jesus doesn't command us to know all about Him. He invites us to know Him and follow Him. My friends, are you hurting or persecuted today because you're trying to live according to your understanding of God's Word? Are you confused or dismayed by the direction of our culture these days? If you are, that may this season of Advent serve as a reminder to you to employ the principle of maximum demand. Troubles, opposition, and persecution can actually make us stronger, more efficient, more joyful servants of Christ. It's not simply what we know, it's to whom we cling. It's the one for whom we prepare our hearts to receive. This is the hope upon which we can build strong faith. A faith that will enable us to recognize Christ when He comes. On this second Sunday in Advent, I'd like to share with you a true story, first told by Howard Schade in Reader's Digest in December 1954. Wonderful, true story. It's the story of a young pastor called to a church in a city that had long since passed its days as what we often refer to wrongly as a tall, steeple church. The church had entered a period of decline. The pastor and his wife, however, were full of optimism and love and hope that with God's help they could turn the church around. Late one December, however, a severe winter storm of rain and ice assailed the church, causing a huge chunk of plaster to fall from the wall right behind the altar. The crestfallen pastor and his wife cleaned up the plaster mess, but they couldn't hide the ragged hole that it left. With Christmas only 2 days away, the couple attended an auction for the benefit of a youth group. At one point, the auctioneer opened a box and removed a gold and ivory-laced tablecloth, a handsome piece of art. Despite the fact that it represented a long-vanished era, there were only a few half-hearted bids until the young pastor lit up with a great idea, and he bid $6.50 for it. He took it to the church the next day, and he tacked it up on the wall behind the altar, right behind the altar, where it completely hid the hole. And actually looked amazing. Just before noon on the day of Christmas Eve, as the pastor opened the church, he noticed a woman waiting for the bus across the street. He called out to her and told her that the bus on that route wouldn't be there for another 45 minutes. And he invited her inside to stay warm. And she gladly accepted his invitation. She had come to the neighborhood to be interviewed for a job as a governess for two small children, but she had been turned down. As a war refugee, her English was not yet perfect. She sat down in the pew and she clasped her hands, preparing to pray. When she looked up and she saw the young pastor adjusting the gold and ivory-laced tablecloth on the wall, she rushed to the front of the sanctuary, never taking her eyes from the tablecloth. And while the pastor was explaining the storm damage and the hole behind the tablecloth, she rubbed the fabric between her two fingers. Looking at the pastor, she said, with tears starting to roll down her face, "It's mine. It's my banquet cloth." She told the pastor her name and then lifted the corner of the cloth to show the pastor her monogrammed initials. "My husband had it made for me in Brussels. There couldn't be another one like it." She was from Vienna. She and her husband had to leave quickly because they opposed the occupation of their country. Her husband had put her on the train to Switzerland, and he was to follow shortly after her departure But he wanted to go back and gather some of their most prized family possessions, like things like pictures of the family, family heirlooms. But he never made it. The pastor offered her the cloth, but she looked at it on the sanctuary wall, and she couldn't take it. As soon as they parted, she boarded the bus to return home. Following the Christmas Eve candle lighting service, the pastor greeted people at the door, many of whom told the pastor how beautiful the gold and ivory lace tablecloth looked behind the altar. But one man, a gentle-faced man who repaired watches and clocks in town, stopped and with a puzzled look recounted in a soft foreign accent how much it resembled the one that his wife had owned, and added, "May God rest her soul." Indeed. By Christmas morning, by the next day, the pastor who had secured a car and the address of the woman from the couple she interviewed with delivered the man and the tablecloth to his beloved wife. Why, you may ask, is this story significant to me? Well, because I know that many of us have experienced loss this year. Many are facing pain, are lonely in this season, and many have questions. Will my cancer be healed? Will the painful divisions in my family ever be mended? Will my son or daughter ever come to acknowledge how much God loves them, how much I love them, and allow themselves to be drawn to Christ by the gift of the Holy Spirit in their lives? My friends, if you feel devastated, if you have questions that are not easily answered, if life has put you to the maximum demand of what you believe your faith can withstand, may this Advent be an interval of spiritual renewal and rest for you. Let your heart and soul take comfort in the hope which is ours in Jesus Christ, born so that we might know God and His ever-present love and comfort in our times of need. Yes, let us pause from our frantic pace and be renewed in our faith in Christ, born in a manger for our salvation, our redemption, our hope, our peace. Indeed, God is present. Thanks be to God. In the name of God, the Father, Son, and Holy Spirit. Our hymn today is actually not